structure and function of DNA. So firstly, the structure can be divided into the primary structure, the secondary structure, the tertiary structure. So the primary structure would be the base sequences. Simply, it's the nucleotide sequence in the nucleotide chain. All right, as we all know that a human genome is too long and it is compacted, and it is compacted into a chromosome or chromatin, and then it is fitted into the nucleus, or inside the nucleus it is present in a very compact form. So the length of DNA can be too long. For example, in cases of humans, it's 2-3 billion base pairs. Now let's take a look at the chain of DNA. This is the chain of RNA, and here we can see the phosphodiester bond, which is between 3 prime and 5 prime carbons. And here we see this is the 5 prime end with a phosphate group, and this is the 3 prime end of the strand with a free hydroxyl group. The polynucleotide chain is formed by means of the attachment of these nucleotide units with the help of this phosphodiester bond. Although one thing that is to be kept in mind is the chain is read in the 5 prime to 3 prime direction. Okay. Now let's come to the secondary structure. The secondary structure is defined as the relative spatial position of all the atoms of the nucleotide residues. So it's basically where are they positioned, how are the atoms positioned inside the nucleotide residues, that will tell you about the secondary structure. So the secondary structure of the DNA double helix was discovered by James Watson and Francis Crick. As told earlier, that the DNA double helical structure was discovered by Watson and Crick in 1953. Before that, the scientists knew that the DNA is made up of nucleotides, but exactly how are they placed, what is the positioning of the atoms inside the molecules, it was not very clear. So the hint or the sources of data through which they were able to come out with this model is, first is the Chargaff's finding. The Chargaff's finding was that that the DNA that was derived from variety of sources, all of them showed that the amount of purines was always equal to the amount of pyrimidine. That means, in other words, the amount of G-guanine was equal to the amount of cytosine, and similarly, the amount of adenine was equal to thymine. Or, in short, the amount of pyrimidine was always equal to the amount of purine. This is what the Chargaff law states. Okay, so this was one finding. The second thing was the Rosalind Franklin's X-ray diffraction image of DNA. These diffraction images of DNA showed a helical structure with regularities at 0.34 nanometer and 3.4 nanometer along the axis of the molecule. So basically, these two findings led to the discovery of this DNA double helix model. Okay. So this is Francis Crick and this is James Watson, and the discovery of the DNA double helix was made on the basis of these two, the Chargaff's rule, which says that the number of pyrimidine and purine will be equal in DNA. However, in RNA, this is not the rule. This rule is there for DNA. RNA, because it's a single-stranded molecule, it does not follow the Chargaff's rule. Nevertheless, because of these two, here we can see this X-ray diffraction image, and because on the basis of these two, the DNA double helix model was discovered by Watson and Crick. Now let's take a look at the molecular structure of DNA. Okay, so in this we can see that it is made up of, this double helical structure is made up of two polynucleotide chains. These are the two polynucleotide chains which are wound around each other in a right-handed helix. It's a right-handed helix. So these two chains are wound around each other in a right-handed helix, and these are wound around an axis. The helix has an axis. Alright. And another finding is that these two chains are anti-parallel. Anti-parallel means one is in the direction of 5 prime to 3 prime, while the other one is in the direction of 3 prime to 5 prime. Here another thing to note is that the sugar phosphate backbone, okay, which are basically the hydrophilic molecules or hydrophilic part of this molecule, these are present on the periphery. These are present outside of the helix, while the nitrogenous bases, which are basically more hydrophobic, they are on the inside and they are stacked perpendicularly to the long axis of the helix. So the bases are stacked inside and they are perpendicular to the axis of the helix, and it looks very much like the steps of a spiral staircase. Okay, so these are the findings. Apart from these, we can see when we get into more details that the bases of these two strands are held together by hydrogen bonds. Okay, so the hydrogen bonds between adenine and thymine are two. The hydrogen bonds that keep thymine and adenine together are two. And for holding together cytosine and guanine, three hydrogen bonds are required. Alright. So, similarly, just because these hydrogen bonds are not very strong, they are relatively weak, and when there is increase in temperature or heating is applied, then these bonds may break and that may lead to separation of the bases. In other words, the separation of the strands, which is also known as melting. Now, this complementary base pairing, this hydrogen bonding, where in adenine thymine there are two hydrogen bonds, while we can see that in guanine cytosine there are three hydrogen bonds. So to break these hydrogen bonds, more energy or more heat would be required. So any strand that has more or higher GC content will need much more energy or higher energy or higher temperature for melting or separation of the strands. We can see that there is complementary base pairing. That means the sequences of one strand will dictate the sequence of the other strand. Okay, so now we can also see this, that the base pairs were 0.34 nanometer apart. I'm going to show you. The base pairs were 0.34 nanometers apart, and the whole one turn that this helix takes, it covers 10 base pairs. Alright, and so the distance across this whole one helix is 3.4 nanometer. Okay, the whole one turn is 3.4 nanometers. Okay, and the diameter of this helix, the dia of this helix is 2 nanometers. Okay, and there are also grooves, minor and major grooves. This also I'm going to show. There are minor and major groups. Just because there is complementary base pairing and the arrangement of sugars and phosphate is such that there are formation of groups which are not equal. There are minor groups and major groups. And these groups are also important because they act as sites for binding of drugs or regulatory proteins. There can be binding of drugs in the minor group, and for the major group there may be sites of binding of regulatory proteins that may help in the expression of gene expression. Okay. Now again we can see here that there are two separate strands. Those are anti-parallel interaction. That means one is 5 prime to 3 prime and the other one is 3 prime to 5 prime. So the two strands that make up the double helix, they are anti-parallel, and the base pairing, you can see the hydrogen bonds and the complementary sequencing. And again, there is sugar and phosphate backbone negatively charged on the outside, and base pairs, they stack one above the other inside. Okay. So base pairing is adenine and thymine, two hydrogen bonds, and guanine and cytosine, three hydrogen bonds. Now, the DNA can be present in mostly in three forms we have studied, and the most standard form of DNA is the B form. So the double helical model that Watson and Crick discovered was actually the B form of DNA double helix, and this is the standard form of DNA. Mostly the DNA is found in the B form. So the B form of DNA, apart from this B form of DNA, there are A form of DNA and Z form of DNA. So the B form of DNA, there are some differences between B, A and Z form of DNA. We'll discuss them later. So the Watson and Crick model, the double helical model that they suggested, was actually B form of double helix, DNA double helix. It's a right-handed helix, and the diameter is 2 nanometer. As I said earlier, the distance between the two base pairs is 0.34 nanometer, and each turn of the helix involves 10 bases. That means 10 bases are crossed while the two strands have one round of the helix. Alright. And this stable configuration is maintained by means of these hydrogen bonds and hydrophobic interactions, the base stacking force. This stabilizes the DNA double helix. For the groove binding, I told you that there is site for binding of drugs and proteins in these minor and major grooves. So mostly in the minor groove drugs may bind, and in the major grooves protein motifs may bind or interact. So as I told you that the conformations of DNA that are mostly red are of these B DNA is the most common and the standard form. And the steady ones are, apart from the B DNA, there are A DNA and Z DNA. Okay. So these are the three forms. This is A DNA, this is B DNA, and this is Z DNA. Okay. So B form is the duplex structure proposed by Watson and Crick. It is the standard form of DNA. And A form is basically the dehydrated form. At low humidity, the DNA molecule may take the A form. The A form is wider and shorter, as you may see, it's more compact than helical structure than the B form helix. And as you may see here, Okay, I'll show you in the next slide. Z form of DNA is adapted by short oligonucleotides. So this one is dehydrated form, this is the standard form, and this form is taken by short oligonucleotides, and these two are right-handed helix, double helix, while this one is a left-handed double helix. Okay, the major characteristics and differences between the three forms is DNA. A DNA is the dehydrated form. It is not usually found in the cell. It is a round right-handed helix, all right, with 11 base pairs per turn. This 10.9, let's take it as 11 base pairs per turn, while for B DNA it is 10 base pairs per turn, and for Z DNA it is 12 base pairs per turn. Okay, all right, the inclination from the helical axis is also different. For the A DNA, the inclination is 13 degrees, while for B DNA, it's very less as compared to A DNA, 2 degrees. A DNA has a deep and narrow major groove and wide and shallow minor groove, while for B DNA, it has a wide major groove and a narrow minor groove, but the depth is same. The depth is same, but the major groove is wide and the minor groove is narrow. And Z DNA is basically a left-handed helix with zigzag sugar phosphate backbone. It has a deep minor groove and a very shallow major groove. This is how it is. Now coming to the tertiary structure of DNA, the tertiary structure of DNA is in the form of supercoils. The double-stranded circular DNA may form supercoils. That means over and above the double-stranded structure, it may further coil up, and that will be known as supercoils. That supercoiling may be negative or positive. So this is the DNA in a prokaryotic cell, and you can see that this is a supercoil, the coiling over and above the double helical structure. The advantage of this supercoiling is it makes the DNA molecule more compact, thus important for its packaging into the cell. Here also you may see supercoiling of DNA. For eukaryotic DNA, the DNA in eukaryotic cell is highly packed, and it appears in a highly ordered form chromosome. So as we all know that DNA appears in a highly ordered form, in a very compact form inside the nucleus of the cell, and during the metaphase it is in the form of chromosomes, while in the resting phase or in other phases it is in a relatively loose form of chromatin. So for this compaction, for this packaging of DNA, the DNA is packaged along with histone proteins, and the basic unit for this chromatin is nucleosome. So the organization of DNA into chromosomes, how is the DNA packaged or compacted into chromosomes, this we'll see. Cellular DNA is organized into chromosomes. Okay, a genome is basically, so DNA, what is DNA? DNA or the genome is basically a set of DNA fragments that collectively form a genome. These DNA fragments, if they are smaller fragments, a certain set of nucleotides, DNA fragment that is able to encode for a certain protein, we call that a gene. And similarly, when all the fragments of DNA are taken into one entity, then it is called a genome. Okay. In eukaryotes, what happens is the genome is one complete set of nuclear chromosome. as we know that in the G1, each chromosome is a single structure in the form of chromatin, while at M phase and during cell division, the sister chromatids are separated into daughter chromosomes. So at M phase, the genetic material is found in the form of chromosomes, while in the G1 phase, it is seen as chromatin. Okay, so formation of this chromatin and further compaction into chromosome, all of this is done with the help of histone proteins and non-histone proteins. This is basically by the help of proteins that form DNA protein complex. So by forming this complex, they are conserved and compacted. And for this compaction, both histone and non-histone proteins are involved, but primarily the DNA forms a complex with histone proteins, and to add to it later on, non-histone proteins are also added to this to further compact the DNA. So something about the histones. Histones are basically small proteins and they have a net positive charge. This net positive charge is because of high numbers of basic amino acids in these histone protein molecules. So they are rich in basic amino acids like arginine, lysine and histidine. That gives it a net positive charge, and this net positive charge helps interact better with DNA, which actually carries negative charge because of all the phosphate that is present. So what happens is histones organize DNA, condense it and prepare it for further condensation by non-histone proteins. So histones are the basic players in the condensing and compaction of DNA. So the chromatin formation involves histones, and it condenses the DNA so that it can fit into the cell. And this is done by help of the histone proteins. The histone proteins are, the most important ones are H1, H2A, H2B and H3 and H4. Okay, so the H2A, H2B, H3 and H4 together they form an octamer. It forms a core. It forms an octameric core with two H2A molecules, two H2B molecules, two H3 and two H4. It forms a octameric histone core. So for this, after this histone core, to this histone core, the DNA is wrapped around. For each octameric histone core, the DNA wraps around twice around it. And then there is this linker DNA. To this linker DNA, H1 histone is attached. Okay. So this is one single unit or nucleosome of chromatin. Okay, so this regular association of DNA with histone forms structures like nucleosome, and then there is this linker DNA. When you see it from above, so this is the diagrammatic representation. This is the octamer formed by four types of histone proteins. These form the histone core to which the DNA is wound around or wrapped around. And then there is this linker DNA to which H1 histone is bound. This H1 histone along with the linker DNA helps in further compaction and further bringing closer these nucleosomes to each other and further compaction. When one looks through electron microscope at this stage onto this molecule, then it looks like beads on a string because of the DNA bound over the octamer core of histone. So this further condenses into This further condenses by connecting nucleosome to create chromatin with a diameter of 30 nanometers. This we'll see further, that this is how they are further compacted with 6 nucleosomes per turn, and then again these solenoid will be arranged over a scaffold, which is it will be arranged over a scaffold or matrix protein, and then this is further compacted, and this compaction continues till it forms a very compact and dense and condensed chromosome. This is how the compaction of DNA occurs, so that it can fit into the cell nucleus of the cell. This is all about the structure of DNA and about the importance of DNA. What is the importance of packing DNA? The importance of packing DNA is it will form a compact form that can fit into the cell. It will also protect the DNA from damage, and it will be easy to transmit this chromosome to the daughter cells, and it confers an overall organization to each molecule of DNA, which is facilitative in gene expression as well as recombination. I think that is all for today, and we can continue with the rest of whatever remains in the next lecture. Thanks for patient listening, and if you have any doubts, we can clear it out later.